Seem like the whole city go against me. Every time I'm in the street, I hear yak, 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 yak. Men down.
All right. Welcome back to Playhouse Bubble. This is your commissioner, Isaac Schumacher, and this is week 11 of your fantasy basketball recap. Happy New Year. We are on the other side of 2022. It was great to see everyone at the house. We had an epic boot hockey game for those that were able to join us. Kevin ended up getting the game-winning hat trick, so that was very cool to see. It was more than one win that Kevin had this week. Also, congratulations, Kevin, for winning the Fantasy Football Midwest Fucking Losers Championship. We now have a new champion in the house. It is no longer just me and James, which is also fantastic to see. So congratulations, Kevin Andrews. Who would have thought, other than maybe Elliot, Kevin is our first champion of this new era of the Federation. So congratulations. I hope everyone stayed warm this weekend, didn't catch any colds. Keep us updated on any of those COVID symptoms. We have a trade alert to jump into basketball things now. Me, my Destroyers, and Gavin and Katie's Muppets made a deal, a groundbreaking deal this past weekend that sent Tobias Harris and Chris Duarte over to the Muppets in return for the highly coveted Julius Randle, and also one of Gavin's 2023 first-round picks is now mine. So I just want to remind everyone, the trade deadline is exactly 1 week from today. So I'm filming this on Monday. It should be next Monday at noon is the trade deadline. So if you haven't made any deals yet and you're looking to make a deal, just know that's your deadline. Get it done as soon as you can. We have multiple records broken this week. A crazy, crazy week. It was very exciting, as always. And so, but first, let's jump into the game of the week that we had. So please cue the music. And we start off week 11 with the Washington football team is my daddy. Shout out, I get to say that one more time at least. Washington football team is my daddy, favored by 150 over the fat old men. These two teams entered the match with a combined 14 straight wins. It was hard to imagine anyone losing this game. But in the end, it was the fat old men outlasting the Muppet monster. Tony and Jordan keep the streak alive. They beat Gavin and Katie by 120 points. My predictions at the beginning of the week said that Jalen Brunson and Franz Wagner would be the ones that made the difference in this game. They had some input, but when it was all said and done, this game was decided on Kevin Love and Hamidou Diallo. Fresh off of waivers. Oh my God. He put up 100 points. You'll see that later. He made a top ball shout out and everything. But K-Love, he's the guy, man. 100 and something, 200 and something points. Gobert also as a top baller this week. He had something to do with it. And Cam Johnson too, man. Gavin's been hot on the waiver wire. Cam Johnson ended up putting up some big points for Gavin, but it just wasn't enough. It's now 7 straight wins now for the Boston Fat Old Men. Boston strong all the way through interleague play. They won just one game against Mid-City all of last season. The Boston Fat Old Men did. That was against Elliott before he got hot. They haven't lost to Mid-City at all this year, and they're likely not going to lose next week either to Kevin. And so they're going to go undefeated against Mid-City this year. I think the Mid-City Conference has got to start calling him Daddy, honestly, because Gavin, he'll get to call himself the Muppets after winning a bet with Andrew and Madden. So that's all said and done. Also, shout out John Madden, RIP. Also, shout out Betty White, RIP. But Boston stays tied for Al now in first, but remains 1,000 points behind the women for the conference lead. And the Washington football team is my daddy, still remains as a one-game lead in Med City. That was your biggest game of the week. And now we move on to the rest of them, because a flock of angry birds is flying right behind that Muppet monster for Med City. The Geese, they were favored by 430 points over the Ghost. It was the Geese versus the Ghost. And normally the Geese, they pick strategically kind of their best weeks to play is normally against their best opponents. But not this time. The Geese just tarred and feathered the Ghost. The lowly Ghost of Simmons had no chance in this one. They beat Hunter by more points than Hunter's team scored. That's what happened in this game. Hunter, he gets 200 points from Levine and CP3, but that's all I'm going to say about the Ghost, because this was all about what happened in Grand Meadow. 21-61 is a new Swaghouse Bubble record for most points scored in a week. Previous record was 21-40 set by the Muppets in Week 15 last year. No team has ever surpassed 1,900 points in a week this year until now, even. We had a bunch of them last year. I can show them to you later sometime. But LeBron breaks the record for most points scored in a week. Again, plenty of records broken this week. He scored more than 100 points in every game this week. LeBron did, other than last night against the Timberwolves. So shout out Wolves. Russ, DeRozan, Ja, and Sabonis all had more than 230 points as well themselves. This is as high as the East can conceivably fly. But Ja has stepped up this year and been a difference maker. LeBron is hungry and refuses to lay down. DeRozan is presumed alpha dog, really, right now for Chicago. And they're the best team in the East at the moment. Am I expecting 21-61 every week? No, it's not going to happen. But expect to see at least a couple more 1,900 performances from the Geese before we get into the playoffs, because this team is just too hot to slow down right now. They're healthy. They're clicking on all cylinders. All the good players on this team are on good teams. It's looking good for them. James is still one game behind Gavin for the top of Med City, but he narrowed the point difference to just less than 100 now after outscoring the Washington football team as my daddy this week by nearly 600 points. So, watch out. Here we go. Quack, quack. Fly the V. Women were favored 240 over the Freak. We knew about Lucas and Robert's injury woes going into this matchup. And they may be the Freak in the sheets, but damn, they could not handle the heat from those big San Antonio women. Man, Al was on top in this love affair, dominating the Freak by just less than 400 points. The bearded lady, James Harden, led the match in points with 309. Lucas and Robert had all three of their bigs lead their team in points. Just not in the cards this week for them. Both teams came into the match at 7-3. The women leave this match as the 2 seed still in the league, and the Freak leave as the 6 seed. They would be matched up with the Geese now in the playoffs. As it stands, another possible James Brothers showdown for round one. Interesting. The Destroyers were favored by 200 points over the Fire Nation. I wanted to give Elliot the benefit of the doubt for this week, and I thought this game would be much closer than expected. I was completely wrong about that. The Destroyers ransacked the Fire Nation by nearly 600 points, and they finished second on the podium this week. So great to see some of my boys humming again. Outside of LeBron, Vooch led all the league in points with 312. Butler dropped 200 points for the first time since week 6. Excuse me. And Devin Booker leads the way for Elliot in points. Elliot is setting up to be a top 3 pick in this draft, but his pick is going to go to Kevin, who is also projected to be a top 3 pick in the draft. So basically, we're just waiting for Zion's return, if not this year, then next year for Elliot. There's really not much more upside for him with him sitting at 1-10. The Destroyers stay sitting in third in Spamtown. They're the current 5 seed in the playoffs, and our current playoff matchup would be against the Red Hot Fat Old Men. Not who I'd want to see in the first round, honestly. All right, the Riots were favored by 195 over the Heroes. There's not much to say about this game. The Riots left a lot of points on the board this week. They should have finished closer to 1,600 points, but it looks like Breyer had a bit of a holiday hangover, which is okay. It didn't matter because the Heroes didn't crack 1,000 points anyway. New hero, Kyle Kuzma, cracked. He led Kevin's team in points with 195. Jaylen Brown led the Riots after having a top 20 performance yesterday. Halliburton turning into a regular piece of this top scoring list for the Riots as well. That's great to see. And despite the poor performance this week, the Riots move up into 7th place because of what happened in this week's Disrespect Bowl. The football team were favored by 110 points over the Fighting Kwames. I tried to warn them. We knew Andrew was banged up, and it didn't take long for the football team to realize they had underestimated the Kwames, who fought their way to a season-saving 400-point victory. RW3 led the match in points, was the only player to surmount 200 points this week for this match. Joker played just 2 games for the football team, and they weren't his best. He put up a lousy 62 points on New Year's Day. I know, 62. But as for fantasy, it is Andrew winning because this week, Andrew turns 21. If you didn't wish him happy birthday already, wish Andrew happy birthday. He turned 21 yesterday. Congrats, brother. Now you can finally see what alcohol tastes like. I'm so happy for you. I know that you've been waiting so long for this moment. So congratulations. But as for fantasy, it was the Dystonia boys getting the best out of the football team in basketball and in football this week. Not much of a B-day present there, assholes. But Andrew moves down to 8th seed, and Dylan remains viable for the playoffs. with 3 wins now in that 9 seed. So again, watch out. We don't know what's about to happen there, but that's it for your games this week. As for the challenge, Spamtown had a 4-2 advantage this week. That is now a 3-game lead overall. MedCity needs to sweep and outscore Spamtown by 1,400 points this next week to even have a chance at winning. Spamtown is dedicating this dub to Austin legend John Madden. We're flying the geese this week because I'm going to have a Spam shirt on next week, no doubt. But no doubt about it, this year entirely is dedicated to the man himself, John Madden. So that's it for your weekly recap. Now we're on to accolades. All right, for your top ballers this week, no surprise, LeBron James, he wins it, man. Again, he broke the record. It was set at 406.5 by Joker just a couple weeks back, but LeBron beats him by 1 point. He did have 409.5 and then bricked 2 layups against the Wolves late in the game, so just sneaks it out. He does hold the record now, though. Also, a surprise, though, LeBron wins this for the first time, which continues the trend of a new winner every week outside of that Joker that second time when he went fucking crazy for 406. So Vooch and Harden, they both finish above 300. They finish second and third, though, because of LeBron. Giannis is on here, and it makes me sick how many times these other two guys on the list make this list. So I'm not even going to say their names. Fuck the French and fuck wherever the turnover toad hatched from. That's all I'm going to say. Shout out goes to Hamidou Diallo. More to come on him and some other notable players that you'll see later on some top performers list. But that's it for top ballers. Your sleepers this week. Nas Little gets the nod. Congratulations, Fighting Kwame, is for taking up half of this list. Most of the sleepers were the geese, which says a lot, even more about how crazy James's week was. But then Dylan's bench, they just upped him. Burks, Tate, and Little all make the list. Dylan could have beaten Andrew by 500 instead of 400, but he'll just have to take the 400. And then your shout-outs go to Triple J, Jaden McDaniels, and Obi Toppin. Some fun guys on that list right there. So those are your sleepers. Your Rookie of the Week, welcome back, Evan Mobley. He couldn't keep him down for too long. He wins for his 5th time this year, and this is his first time, though, in 4 weeks. So it's been a little bit of a while. It's been a month until we've seen him on this list. But it was not much of a contest. Franz Wagner was a distant second. Jalen Green, he cracks 100 points in a week for the first time since week one. So it's been a really long time for Jalen Green, so it's good to see him back. And then Josh Giddey scores 103. But yeah, that dude did it in one game. That's right, Josh Giddey, triple-double, 103. We'll get to that later. But yes, those are your rookies of the week. Now for your manager of the week, congratulations, Alex Ciola, for not only winning manager of the week, but for setting a new record for best ever success rate at 99%. It's about as good as you can get other than being perfect. So congratulations to Al. This is an absolutely crazy feat. Scored a shit ton of points. Didn't leave any on his bench other than 18 and a half. So I mentioned the Riots earlier had a bad week. You can see just how bad it was here. They had the worst week of managing since Dylan back in week 3. Which is when he was going on his tour down along the East Coast. So not a great week for the 4 teams that are not in the playoffs. They all round out the bottom 5 with Jack and Breyer there. Most teams are either treading towards health or hovering where they were last week at the beginning of the week. So we're hoping that most of these COVID cases are behind us now. Smoother sailing headed into divisional play and playoffs. We can only hope, but it seems like a lot of these players are already going through the protocols and getting out of them. So another new manager of the week, and we've now had half the league win this award. So again, congrats, Al. Amazing feat right there. Very, very fun to see. And now for your manager of the year progress here. It's a crazy looking start, so just look at the bolded portions and like I'll talk you through it here. So Lucas and Robert are our current manager of the year. Gavin and Katie are our clear and close second place manager of the year. James is the epitome of average, and Dylan is the only team in the bottom 3 in each category. Mistakes, lost points, and success rate. So unfortunately, I'm afraid that what this means is Dylan has a pretty decent team. They're scoring quite a bit of points, but they're all ending up on his bench. So I know the Kwames are a tough team to manage, but Dylan is getting in his own way based on these numbers. And so I respect Dylan. He knows a lot about basketball more than mostly everyone in this league. But yeah, I can't, it's just numbers. These numbers don't really lie. I don't know what he could do to solve it, though, I guess. I'm not really sure, but that's what the numbers are telling us. And Med City currently has a better success rate than Spamtown by 1.2%. Spamtown was much worse than Med City even just earlier this year, though, so we've made huge strides in that department. So kudos, boys. We're looking really good. And as far as your top performances this week, we had like 10, 12 top performances. Only five make the top 20, but the only day we've ever had, the only day that we didn't have a player finish above 100 points was on Thursday. So that just shows you how dense the performances were this week. Five new players are on the top 20 list. LeBron didn't have a top performance before this week. Now he has two. Giannis on here for the third time now, and James Harden and Jaylen Brown also make the list. Both of those guys were on here earlier, but then they were kicked off. Now they're back. You now need to score 107 points to make this list. It's getting pretty steep. And now for all the shoutouts. So here are all the players that scored at least 100 points and didn't crack this list. LeBron, 106.5 to open the week, and that was his worst performance because he ended up topping it both the other two times, other than outside the Minnesota game. Ham Diallo, off the waivers, scoring 103 for Gavin. Josh Giddey becoming the youngest player in NBA history to record a triple-double. The big men, Vooch, Capella, and the Fighting Kwame. Chris Boucher, look at that. He actually made the lineup. That's good news. And James Harden again. And Tricky Ricky Rubio making the list for the game that ended his season. Sad news for Ricky Rubio. Ricky was having a career year, and it was taken away early, just like his career year in Minnesota back in the Kevin Love days. K-Love and Rubio were teamed up again in Cleveland. And for the Cavs' sake, you hope that the season doesn't finish the same way the Timberwolves did in 2014. When Rubio went down there. Those are all your shout-outs there. Plenty of good players on the list. Your podium this week, the Geese finished 450 points above second place. The Destroyers finished second place and podium for just the second time this season. And the San Antonio Women get the bronze. They're on here once again. The first time the Muppets missed the podium since week two. So that's crazy as well. The Geese, they carry Med City to outscore Spamtown by just 54.5 points this week. You needed all 2,161 of James's points to pull it off this week, Med City, but you did it. You can pat James on the back for that. And Spamtown still outscoring Med City by 1,400 points, and we hold the challenge tiebreaker. Again, Med City's going to have to sweep Spamtown to even have a chance at the challenge. But the overall record for each conference, because Med City ended up beating Spamtown 24-12. So they have a 666 winning percentage from last year. And so if Spamtown ends up sweeping the series this next week, we'll tie it. Otherwise, Med City's going to have the overall record on us going into next year. But as far as this year goes, we just need one win to get it done, boys. Let's do it. That's it for your accolades. Let's get to some previews. All right, so like I said, Spamtown basically has this challenge locked up. We just need one win, but still some very awesome coin flip matchups this week to go through. So it made it really hard to pick a game of the week. But we start off with the football team narrowly being favorites by 25 points over the Freak in the Sheets. This is an honorable mention game of the week. By far the closest on paper. It feels like the Freak have been overperforming and the football team have been underperforming thus far through the season. So it's the current manager of the year against the laissez-faire guru, basically. So Kyrie is supposed to make his season debut on Wednesday for the football team. Ant is back and everyone else important for Andrew is healthy again too. The Freak is finally healthy again as well, basically at full strength with their main guys. They add Dennis Schroeder to fill in the gap that they lost with Ricky Rubio. I'm going to take the football team in this game, but I wouldn't be surprised whatsoever if Lucas and Rob pull off some witty waiver wire moves and sneak it out. Andrew will need to stay on his toes for this one. I really think so. But this is going to be a very, 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 very fun game to watch. The Fire Nation, they're favored by 125 over the Ghost. The Battle of the 1 and 10s, the Tank Bowl. Hunter isn't trying to win necessarily, but his team is nearly back to full health. Elliot isn't trying to lose necessarily, but his team continues to be decimated by injuries, COVID, and now team mutiny with KPJ pulling an AB in Houston and just dipping left at halftime. So I'm still going to take Elliot to win this game, but who knows? Hunter may just go out and get it, I guess, you know, but that should also be fun to watch. 2-1-10 teams battle for the one overall pick. So women are favored by -270 over the Kwames. Both teams are getting healthy. Everyone other than DeJounte Murray is back for Al, but he just needs to do some conditioning, so he'll be back this week as well. Dylan should get John Collins back this week, but Shai Gilgeous-Alexander just hit health and safety protocols, so that will hurt him. RW3 is nursing a toe injury as well for Dylan. Al would be a favorite in this game regardless of Dylan being fully healthy or not, but I'm going to take Al winning and covering, especially since Dill won't have Shai. That's really, really going to hurt. So not the end of the world for Dylan's playoff chances if he loses, but a loss by Andrew this week would definitely help him out a lot. So again, not the end of the world, but could definitely use some help. Muppets are favored by 215 points over the Riots. This will be fun. Another two teams that, like I said, it was a coin flip when Jaynes played them. Yeah, it's probably a coin flip again with when the Muppets play him. Klay Thompson is projected to make his season debut on Sunday. So that's great news for the Muppets. But Porzingis and Brogdon just hit COVID protos. And so they're still without Ayton, Cole Anthony, and Garland for at least the beginning of the week. Obviously no Paul George either. So for the Riots, their biggest losses are Jason Tatum and Caris LeVert. Those are pretty big. But they get Bridges, Cade, Reggie, and eventually D'Lo back this week. So it should turn out to be a very close matchup talent-wise. I'm going to take the Muppets to bounce back from their loss last week, especially after seeing the managerial performance from the Riots this last week. But this will be an extremely close game, and the Riots will cover at the very least. So the Fat Old Men are favored by 300 points over the Heroes. The scorching hot Fat Old Men should get a cakewalk this week again against Kevin's Heroes. Tony and Jordan have all their top-end talent healthy again outside of AD. Basically, nothing has changed health-wise for Kevin coming out of this week. He was really banged up. Nothing's really changed. Still missing over half of his team with COVID. And now Christian Wood will miss a game after being suspended by the team. Same deal as Kevin Porter. I have no clue what's happening in Houston, but nothing good. Take a look at Kevin's new logo, though. This is clean as hell. They'll be rocking it from here on out to go with their shiny new power forward and Kyle Kuzma. So who they got from the Fat Old Men. So should be fun to see each team showcase their new players, but Boston will win big and cover this time around. And then finally, your game of the week is the Geese, favored 140 over my Destroyers. Aside from being the Commissioner's Cup, this game is also between the two top podium teams from this last week. So obviously the Geese overperformed. They performed much better than my Destroyers did. But it still should be a high power matchup. Jaynes is still completely healthy outside of losing Dinwiddie from COVID. Dort to a little bit of a knee problem, and Whiteside has a concussion right now. So he's not missing out on too much there. The Destroyers should get Kat back this week, but Maxey and newly acquired Julius Randle just hit health and safety protocols. And now Dame is nursing his abdominal tendinopathy again. And so Destroyers are banged up, and even a healthy Destroyers team would need to play pretty damn well to catch the Geese, because they're hot right now, man. It's just a red-hot Geese team. And so Jaynes will win, but I will pick myself to cover, although I don't really believe myself when I say that. It's been a rough road for my boys when it comes to playing the Med-City favorites this year, and it's another rough round this time around, it looks like. So That's it for your everything week 11. If you want me to send you your logos, because I know a lot, some of you, probably most of you, have seen the logos that I made yet. If you want those, reach out to me on Snap. I'll send those over under your ESPN email. If you would like me to make any edits to your logo, also reach out to me and let me know about that. I know Tony had some color recommendations to make for his. So without further ado, that concludes everything for week 11. Reach out, boys, and we'll see you next week. Peace.
Wake your punk ass up. It ain't nothing but a Compton thing. Chill. Real simple and plain. We teach you some lessons about the street.